Today we will continue the same chapter, the Central Islamic Line, and today we will start the new topic, the breakup of the caliphates or khalifa and the rise of the sultanate. So before we go to the topic, first we'll discuss this about what we have done in the previous video. So you can see that after the death of the Prophet Muhammad, the caliphates became the successor of Muhammad. So we read that there was four caliphs who came in an order: Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman and Ali. So Ali was defeated by Muawiyah and he led an Umayyad dynasty which was lasted till 750 AD, and this Umayyad was replaced by this Abbasid, and they belonged to the another family of the Makkah origins. So now we talk about the breakup of caliphate. So you can see Abbasid, the state, it become weaker from the 9th century onward, because this Baghdad, it lost control over the distinct provinces. So what were the reason for Baghdad to lost control over the provinces? So we saw that there was a conflict between two groups or the factions in the army and bureaucrats. One was the pro-Iranian and another was the pro-Arabs. So the supporter of Arab were the pro-Arab, and pro-Iranian the supporter who were supporting Iran. So in 810, a civil war that broke between the supporters of, you can see, Amin and Mamun. Mamun, these both were the son of the Caliph Harun al-Rashid, so which deepened the factionalism and created a new bloc called the Turkish slaves, officers called Mamluk. So Mamluk were used for Turkish slave. So Shiaism now comes once again compete with the Sunni orthodoxy for power. So dynasty of minor, you can see a numbers of minor dynasty that arose, such as Tahiri and Samanid orthodoxy for power in Khurasan and Transoxiana, a land beyond the Oxus. And you will find that this Tulunid in Egypt and Syria. So these were the minor dynasty which emerged during this period. And then we saw Abbasid, its power soon declined, or it is limited to the, if you talk about the area or the region, it is limited to the central Iraq and western Iran. So the regions were too lost in the year 945 AD. When we talk about they lost the regions of central Iraq and western central Iraq and western Iran, when Bayid, okay, a Siyat clan, Bayid we call Buhavi, okay, these are from the Caspian regions of Iran, Delam, they captured Baghdad. So the Bayid ruler, they assumed various title including the ancient Iranian title called Shahanshah, the king of kings, but not that of Caliph. So they kept the Abbasi Caliph as the symbolic or the nominal head for their Sunni subjects. So the decision was not to abolish the caliphates or the caliph was a shrewd one, or they made a clever decisions because of the another Siyat dynasties. So here we see that Ismaili, okay, here Ismaili, he claimed to be the descendant from the Prophet Muhammad's daughter Fatima and hence the sole rightful ruler of Islam. So from their base in North Africa, so they conquered the Egypt, okay, in 969 AD and established the Fatimid caliphates. So the old capital of Egypt, Fustat, was replaced by a new capital called Kahira or Cairo. So between 950 and 1200, there was no single political order as you can emerge of small empire. Or you can see single language or of culture, Arabic, but now they share common economic and cultural patterns. So you can see political divisions, but to maintain unity, okay, state and society was separated and development of Persia on a language of Islamic high culture. So the maturity of dialogues between the intellectual traditions, the scholars, the artists, the merchant, They moved freely within the central Islamic lands and assumed the circulation of ideas and manners. So when we talk about the population of Muslim, it was less than 10% in the Umayyad and early Abbasid. But it increased enormously. The identity of Islam as a religion and a cultural system separated from other religion become much sharper, and which you can see made conversion possible and meaning. So now you can see the third ethnic group which were added to the Arabs, one and another Iranian, were the Turkish Sultanates, okay, in the 10th and 12th centuries. So the Turks were nomadic tribes from the place Central Asia. And then you can see steppe grassland of Turkish, who gradually converted into Islam. So this third group, Turkish, okay, here you can see they were skilled riders and warriors, and you can see and entered the Abbasid, Samanid and Bayad administration, rising to high positions on account of their loyalty and military abilities. So the Ghaznavid Sultanate was established in by Altagin in 961 AD and consolidated by Mahmud of Ghazni. So it was a military dynasty and a professional army of Turks and Indians. So if we talk about one of the general of Mahmud was an Indian name called Tilak. But the center of power was in Khurasan and Afghanistan. And for them the Abbasid Khalis were not rival but a source of legitimacy. So Mahmud was conscious of being the son of slave and was specially eager to receive the title of Sultan from a Khalif. So here the Khalif was also willing to get the support, the Sunni Ghaznavid, as a counterweight to Siyad power. Now come the Seljuk Turks. They entered Turan as soldiers in the armies of the Samanid and Karakhanis. Okay, this Karakhanis were the non-Muslim Turks from far the east. They later established themselves into powerful groups under the leadership of two brothers, Tughril and Chagri Beg. So after the death of Mahmud Ghazni, the Seljuk, they conquered Khurasan in 1037 AD and made Nishapur the first capital. So the Seljuk next turned their attention to the western Persian and Iraq, ruled by Bayats, and in 1055 and restored Baghdad to Sunni rules. So the Khalif Al-Qayyam conferred the Tughril Beg the title of Sultan. It marked an action where there was a separation of religious and political authority. So here you will see the two brothers, Tughril and Chagri Beg, they ruled together, followed the traditions of the tribe, and ruled by a family as a whole. Then Tughril, it was succeeded by Alp Arsalan, okay, his nephew. During Alp Arsalan reign, the Seljuk Empire is expanded to Anatolia, that is in modern Turkey. So from the 11th to 13th century, there was a series of conflict between European Christians and the Arab states. So then at the start of the 13th century, the Muslim world found on the verge of a great disaster, and this was the threat from the Mongols. So now we start a new topic, that is the Crusades. It's a series of military expeditions made by the European to recover their holy land from the Muslim in the 11th, 12th and the 13th century. So in medieval Islamic societies, these Christians, they were regarded as the people of the book, Ahl al-Kitab, okay, since they had their own scriptures, because they are having the religious book, the New Testaments or Injil. That's why they were called people of the book. So the Christians who came as a trader, pilgrimage or ambassador or traveler were given protection on Aman by the Muslim states. So these territories also included those states or regions which were held earlier by the Byzantine rulers. The sacred land of Palestine, the Jerusalem, was won by Arab, you can see, in the year 638 AD. So Jerusalem, it was the place of, you can see, crucifixion of Jesus Christ. It was sacred and holy place for the European, and it was having a religious significant. Okay, so it was ever present in the Christian imagination of Jesus crucifixion, where, you know, Jesus Christ was executed, in which he was tied or nailed to a large wooden beam and left to hang for several days until eventual death from exhaustion and or died due to lack of oxygen. So this was an important factors, okay, of this in the formation of the image of Muslim in the Christian Europe. So here you can see hostility towards the Muslim world. Okay, it became more pronounced in the 11th century. Normans, Hungary, and some Slavs, they had been converted to Christianity, and the Muslim alone remained as the main enemy to the European countries. Okay, so there was also change in the socio-economic organization of Western Europe in the 11th century. The clergy and the warrior class were making efforts to ensure political stabilities as well as, you can see, economic growth based on agricultural trade. So peace of good movement, okay, here we saw socio-economic organizations of Western Europe, changes in this. So we will see the peace of good God movements, okay, to stop the military confrontations between these competitive frontiers state and the revival of economy that is based on plunder. So here you can see forbidden of military violence near the place of worship, certain periods in the church calendars considered sacred, and then certain vulnerable social groups as churchmen and the common people. So this peace of God, this revolution, the movement, it changed the direction, or it divert they divert towards the enemy of God instead of feudalism. It means that this changed direction from the aggressive tendency of feudal society away from the Christian world and toward the enemy of God. So now they divert toward the enemy of God's. So now the revolution, it created an environment in which fight against the non-believers became not only permissible, it's allowed or permitted, but also commendable, it's praiseworthy. So Malik Shah, the Seljuk Sultan, died in 1092 AD. After his death, you can see there's a disintegration of his empire. The Byzantine emperor, here you can see Alexius I, got a chance to regain Asia Minor and northern Syria. For Pope Urban II, it was the time of the revival of Christianity. So in 1095, okay, Pope joined the Byzantine in calling for a war in the name of the Holy Lands. So between 1095 and 1291, the Western Europe Christians, they planned to fought against Muslim cities in the coastal plains of the Eastern Mediterranean, Levant. So you will see there was a series of war, and this war was designated as Crusade War for Religion. So in the first crusade, a war for religion, in the year 1098-99, soldiers from France and Italy, they captured Antioch in Syria and occupied Jerusalem. So their victory was accompanied by slaughters of Muslims and Jews in the city, and it was chronicled by both Hindu and Muslim. So a series of events were recorded in factual and in a detailed way. So Muslim writers, they regarded the arrival of Christians as a You can see Frankish invasion or Firangis. The Frank quickly established four crusade states. The regions that was won by the religion war in the region of Syria and Palestine. So collectively these territories were known as Outremer. Okay. Land overseas and later crusade were directed as its defense and expansions. So here we see the second crusade war that was fought in land 45 to 49. So the Outremer, it survived well for some time. But when the Turk captured Edessa in the year 1144, you can see an appeal was made by the Pope for a second crusade or the religious war. One troop of German and French army, they made an attempt to capture Damascus, but they were defeated and forced to return home. So after this, there was a gradual decline in the strength of Outremer. The fourth state, the region of Syria and Palestine. So now the excitement for crusades war was lost. Now the Christians, they fought for the expansion of territories, and you can see they give way for the life luxurious. Okay, here you can see now the Saladin created an combined army of Egyptian and Syrian and gave the call for jihad and holy war against these Christians and defeat them in 1187. So he regained this Jerusalem nearly a century after the first crusade. The inscription of that time shows that his behavior was kind toward the Christians. In contrast, the behavior of Christians where they killed or slaughtered to the Muslims and Jews. So although he gave custody to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre to the Christians, a number of churches were turned into mosques, and you will see Jerusalem once again became a Muslim city. So this loss of city, the Holy Land, it provoked a third crusade in 1189. But the crusades gained little except for some coastal town in Palestine and free access to Jerusalem for Christian pilgrimage. So the Mamluk, the ruler of Egypt, they finally drove the crusading Christians from all the Palestine in 1291. Even the Europe, they generally lost military interest in Islam and focused on its internal political and cultural interests. So what were the impact of this crusades? So there was a great impact, okay, on the and we will see it on two aspects. One was the relation between English and Christians. So if we talk about that this Muslim state, okay, their attitude toward their Christian subjects were very harsh, which was the result of the bitter experiences of war and the security in the area of mixed population. The second impact here, or the great it was the great influence of these Italian communities from Pisa, Genoa and Venice. So they were having a great influence in the trade route between East and West after the restoration of Muslim also. Italian, it influenced the trade between the East and the West.